The riverbed that runs through this great Victorian aqueduct was the birthplace of one of England's most famous fictional animal heroes. Find out who he was and what county I'm in just a few moments. On today's show, we're challenged to find the perfect rural hideaway with lots of land. And it seems the more remote, the better.
I'd just love to be stuck in the middle of nowhere. I love it. It's really pretty.
And there's much more to love when we uncover a potential home that may deliver the dream.
With this property, you also get over 2 acres of land.
No! Oh, my goodness!
Don't! You're going to start me off! Today I'm in Devon, and behind me is the Beam Aqueduct, or Canal Bridge, as the author Henry Williamson called it in his classic novel Tarka the Otter, published back in 1927. Williamson's accurate description of the River Torridge and the surrounding countryside now form the 180-mile Tarka Trail. So along with the chance of spotting an otter, you also get to explore a landscape that has hardly changed since the book was written all those years ago. Lying in the southwest peninsula, Devon shares land borders to the west and east, with the Bristol Channel to the north and the English Channel to the south. The southwest coastal path spans each shoreline, 65% of which is designated heritage coast, noted for its natural beauty, wildlife and historical significance. Along the north coast, Clovelly sprang up as a fishing harbour. Much of it's inaccessible to cars, making the muddle of cobbled streets a delight to explore on foot. The steep gradient here meant goods were traditionally delivered by donkeys. Although the donkey work is now done by sledge, the much-loved animals are still a popular sight in the village. Devon also boasts many architectural gems. The 12th-century Hartland Abbey was the last monastery seized under the dissolution of the monasteries. So whether it's historic buildings, remote moorland, or quaint seaside vistas, Devon is a wonderful place for a temporary or more permanent rural escape. The average cost of a detached home here in Devon is around £310,000. That's £23,000 above the national average. But don't forget that that figure includes the property hotspots of Salcombe to the south and Croyde to the north, where homes can often sell for double the national average. Move further inland and you get more for your money, particularly around the market towns of South Moulton and Tavistock. So with that in mind, let's meet today's buyer and find out where they'd like to settle. Pharmacist Julie from Shoreham-by-Sea in West Sussex is about to embark on a complete change of lifestyle and has set her sights on relocating to the West Country.
I've wanted to move westwards for quite some time now. I just think it's a dream of mine and I can achieve it. As children, we used to go caravanning, tenting down in Devon. So I just feel I've grown up with that countryside and I've got a genuine love of it.
And helping her to realise this dream is good friend and work colleague, fellow pharmacist Mirella.
I think basically I'm just there to support her, and if I see something that I think would be right, I would actually say what is right and what I think is right.
I tend to go by my heart rather than my brain, and I'm hoping Mirella will be the brain in this.
Absolutely.
Moving will of course mean leaving behind the 3-bed end of terrace that's been Julie's home for the last 15 years. And though she's enjoyed living there, she's now after a more peaceful pace of life.
Shoreham, I feel, is definitely becoming more busy. Lots more traffic coming through. I hanker after the country life. I've just come back from a week's holiday in Devon, and I just felt I'd come home, as it were. It's a slice of heaven in my eyes.
By turning her holiday destination into a permanent address, Julie hopes to expand on her hobbies, spend more time with her dogs, and maybe even add some livestock to the list.
She's so in love with animals. everything in her life is around animals. So, yeah, it's very, very important to her.
I'd like to be able to get more animals, some chickens, maybe adopt a donkey or two.
Goats. Everything, you know. I've never seen Devon, but I'm excited to go, and I could get the Devon bug. I want to move down there myself.
Julie wants us to focus our house search in the north of the county, where she hopes to get the best value for her property pound. And before we start the search, I'm meeting up with the two friends in the county to find out even more about the specifics of this move. Welcome to Devon. So what is it about Devon in particular that makes you dream of living here?
It's just so beautiful and, most of all, it's quiet.
Well, let's talk about the right place,
yes.
about what you imagine from it and also what you need from it.
Well, I don't mind if it's fairly isolated. I don't mind if it's near a village. I feel that I'm quite good at making friends. I'd like preferably a detached house with some land. And that's the top of my list, the land aspect, because I'm just mad on animals and I'd love to have a horse or some chickens, etc. I want to live a bit of the good life, really, I think, and maybe grow my own veggies as well.
So we've got a room for all the animals. What about for the friends when they come to stay?
Minimum two bedrooms. Maybe three would be good. Like most people, we want a big kitchen, the heart of the house.
This is a really big life change for you, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think, Rihanna, that Julie's not going to compromise on in this search?
I think the land's important because of the animals that she wants to have. I think that's probably the only thing.
Mm.
Yeah.
If the property didn't come with much land, as long as there was some land nearby that I could maybe rent, that would be a good compromise.
So, Julie, remind me of the budget that we're working with on the search.
I've got £350,000.
Any wiggle room on that for the right property?
Maybe for the dream property, yes. Maybe a little bit more.
Okay. Well, it's a great budget for this part of the country, and we've got some fantastic properties to show you. So are you both ready?
Yep.
Let's go house hunting. Julie has confirmed that she's happy to stretch her budget to a maximum of £375,000. And for that figure, she's looking for a detached house with 2 to 3 bedrooms and a large kitchen, not forgetting land to keep some animals. She's after a tranquil, rural setting with easy access to both coast and countryside. We've got some wonderful houses lined up, all in beautifully appealing settings, but the price tags won't be revealed until the end of each tour. Our final property is the mystery house, which will challenge on look, lifestyle, and location. Our property search is heading to the hamlet of West Anstey. A picturesque hamlet right on the edge of the Exmoor National Park, this is a rural location with all the walks, woodlands, and wildlife you could hope for. And when it comes to local amenities, the small town of Dulverton is a 5-mile drive away, just over the border and into Somerset. But it's a short drive into the surrounding countryside where we find the house I want Julie to see. So this is what I brought you to see. Oh!
Oh, my word.
Come on closer, take a proper look.
I like this jewellery. Oh,
wow.
This looks really lovely.
That's a brilliant positive reaction.
Oh, yeah. And the view, look at that.
Yeah, it's a fantastic view, isn't
it?
Oh,
it's amazing. It's fantastic.
It's so
quiet. You look quite emotional.
I know, it's lovely.
The house looks really nice. The garden's pretty as well, isn't it?
I couldn't have asked for a better reaction to the outside. So why don't we go in and explore and see if we can keep that very big smile on your face. Well, that's exactly the response I was hoping for. The breathtaking location is a clear winner, but I wonder what they'll make of the house. It dates back to 1870 and is actually a former schoolhouse until it was lovingly converted under its old slate roof. So we come straight into the entrance hall. Now, this would have been the old kitchen in the old house. From this large hallway, which is doubling up as a snug, the ground floor of the property is split into two halves. In the right-hand side, which is the original part of the building, there's also a sitting room and stairs up to the first floor. But first for us is the newer extended wing over on the left-hand side.
But an extension to here was done 15 years ago, so actually there's a fantastic-sized kitchen diner that I'm sure you'll be looking forward to seeing.
Hey, I like this.
Look at the smile.
I like this, Julie. Yeah.
What do you like about it?
It's really nice and warm.
I love it.
She likes it. She likes it.
What do you like about it, Julie?
Well, it's not just a square box. I just love the units. It's a bit quirky because you've got a step down. It's just lovely. And you've got a little courtyard there. I love it.
There's another entrance through the side to the back of the house. Oh. In there is a boot room, a downstairs bathroom. So if you're out with the dogs, you can come in and get rid of your dirty, muddy boots and clean the dogs off in there.
I'm a bit overwhelmed, I have to say. Just got a really good feel.
It's nice to see such big smiles on your faces.
Yeah, it's really lovely. I like it.
Well, we've still got more to explore. Let's wander through into the sitting room.
This is nice.
Nice, isn't it? Yeah. With a second log burning stove and some nice views.
Oh, it's lovely.
It's really bright
and small,
cheerful.
But it's perfect for what I want.
It's cosy, isn't it?
Lovely.
You're still getting that nice feeling?
Yes. Yes. Just as excited.
Are you?
Love it.
Good.
I think it's safe to say that this property is really tugging on Julie's heartstrings, as the ground floor rooms have obviously resonated with her. I just hope the feeling continues upstairs. Here there's a bright family bathroom and three bedrooms. All are comfy doubles, and two feature double aspect windows, allowing the light to flood in. And those beautiful views across lush farmland draw you in as soon as you step inside the rooms. That leaves just one more bedroom to see, and that's the master.
You can see the character of the property here.
Yeah.
That's nice.
It's nice, isn't it?
The views are superb, aren't they? You can't really.
I really like it.
What are you looking worried about? You look really worried. What's going through your mind?
I'm just waiting for something to be wrong.
Are you waiting for the butt?
Yes. Okay. It's just been so lovely so far.
Although Julie's a little anxious, I'm confident the outside space will also deliver. So we're heading downstairs to throw open the door and explore the garden. It's mostly laid to lawn, framed by beech hedging, but what hits you straight away has to be that incredible vista across deeply rural Devonshire fields. But if we take our attention back to what's on offer with this property, I've got something else to reveal.
The sunsets are just over there in the west and they're apparently absolutely beautiful.
Perfect. I love a west-facing back garden.
Yeah.
So you've probably noticed the old barn there in the corner with the stables. You're probably going to need that, I'd have thought, because with this property you also get over 2 acres of land.
No! Oh my goodness!
You're going to start me off!
Oh my goodness!
My heart's going like mad. I'm just so excited about it. I'm just praying that price is OK.
OK. So, would you like to go and explore the rest of the land?
Yes, please.
Beyond the stable block are three paddocks currently used for horses. But with 2 acres of land, there should be enough room for even more animals.
I could have sheep as well. That's more than enough. That's fantastic.
Well, you know Julie well. Is this the kind of place you could see her being?
I think this is a place that she would find herself at home.
And now comes the difficult bit, because I have to ask you to guess the price.
I'm going to say 375.
I'm thinking 385, 90 maybe.
Let me put you both out of your misery. Mm-hmm. Julie, you are absolutely spot on.
I'm so happy.
It's on the market for £375,000, and there could potentially be a small amount of negotiation on that price as well. How you feel?
That's brilliant.
Now, I know the land has always been something that really matters to you, so I would normally say go back in and have another look around the house, but why don't you just go and explore the land?
I will do.
OK, off you go. Come on.
On budget, with a price tag of £375,000, This proposition is indeed a perfect match to Julie's wish list. A detached Victorian property. It has three bedrooms and the large kitchen diner she wants, along with a sitting room featuring views out to the garden. A whopping 2 acres of land should be more than ample for chickens and rescue ponies. And the stunning, peaceful location seems to be spot on.
I love this house right from the word go. I like the outside, the views are just stunning. Inside the kitchen, it's got lots of features, the lovely bare wood, the wood-burning stoves.
I could see in Julie's face that she loved it. It was written all over her face, so... And then when we went inside, she fell in love even more with it. And then when she saw the land, that finished it.
The 2 acres of land is just amazing. It's just incredible. I'm so happy.
You had a good explore.
Oh, we have, we have.
And that smile's still on your face.
Yes, I want to stay.
Well, you can't because the search isn't over and there's more to see. So I'm going to drag you away, I'm afraid.
OK. OK, come on.
With their origins in medieval war horses bred from stock brought over after the Norman conquest, Britain's working horses, whether drawing carts or tilling the fields, were once a common sight across the country. However, during the first half of the 20th century, oil-fueled vehicles like tractors came to be seen as cheaper, faster, and less demanding, and so the nation's equine labour was slowly replaced. But rising concern for the environment, along with nostalgia for our agricultural heritage, means some farmers are bringing horses back to the land. We're sending animal lover Julie, along with Morella, to meet traditional farmer Ben May. He's offered to show them how he uses shires to work his 60 acres of Devon countryside.
Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to Lower Upcott Farm.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you for having us.
So, what methods do you use here?
Well, we actually use our horses a lot to do our farm work. So we do our haymaking with the horses, and we do all our sort of muck spreading in the winter, and then the rolling and the harrowing in the spring. And then we do a whole lot of horse logging work, both on the farm and commercially. I suppose it's a little bit like a 1940s farm, but we kind of like to think we're the best of the past and the best of the future. I think Tom's getting a little bit keen to get on with some work, so shall we move on and do some horse logging?
Yeah, let's go.
Okay, come on, boy.
Shire horses are more manoeuvrable than tractors, can deal with boggier and steeper terrain, and don't leave ruts in the land. Ben and his horses often work for organisations like the National Trust in environmentally sensitive locations. Tom's task today is shifting some felled timber. The woodland at the farm is mixed and includes some large oak, along with smaller trees like ash, willow and hazel.
Over. Good boy, walk on.
As Ben is keen for his farm to be as self-sufficient as possible, much of the wood is used to heat the farmhouse or turned into charcoal.
And woo.
But Ben also uses offcuts in the farm workshop, where he has another traditional technique that Julie and Morella can turn their hands to.
So I've got a piece of hazel here that's come up from the woods, and we're going to make a parasol mushroom. So if you'd like to sit down and have a go, and I'll just show you what you need to do. So if you put your 2 feet on each side of this, then that's a vice for you, so it means you don't have to hold a piece of wood while you're doing the work.
A draw knife is used to shave the end of the hazel pole, which will form the stalk of the mushroom. It's the same basic tool that was used in medieval times to make chair legs.
Turn the piece of wood around, and then you keep going effectively until you've got a bit of a point. Well, that's great, Julie. Good stuff. Why don't you have a go, Morella? Your turn.
Love to.
Using the wood from his mixed woodland, Ben makes a range of cottage crafts from furniture to signs and decorative items.
That's it, good stuff. I think that's great. What I'll do now is I'll just take this out and we'll put it together. We've got this here, and then that goes on here. So there we go.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
One handcrafted garden mushroom completed, it's no time for us to reflect on the first day of house hunting in Devon until the search for Julie's dream home continues tomorrow. It's the start of our second day of property shopping for animal-loving Julie from Shoreham-by-Sea in West Sussex, who's chosen to get away from it all in the county of Devon. With a budget of £375,000, she's brought her friend Mirella along to help her find a dream country home with some land. So far, we've visited an ideal house that could prove hard to beat.
I'm just so excited about it.
But still to come, our mystery house puts her right in the thick of things with an alternative outlook and style.
What do you think?
It's different.
Different in a good way, different in a bad way.
No, it looks very attractive, actually.
And I'm joining the harvest when I visit a traditional Devon orchard and then enjoy the fruits of our labour.
It's so sweet and zingy and fresh tasting.
It's the second day of our house hunt here in Devon, and what became clear yesterday was that the land is as important to Julie as the house itself. Well, we'll be putting that to the test with our mystery house, which will offer Julie a slice of village life in the heart of a thriving community. But first, we're off to see a property that would allow Julie to put her own stamp on her home here in Devon. How will she feel about a challenge like that? To start the day, we're heading closer towards the north coast, and our destination is just outside the village of Parkham. Being a small rural place, there aren't too many amenities in the village, but there is a thatched 13th century cobwalled pub and a 14th century church. The village is less than a mile from the next house, and so within walking distance for Julie and her dogs. Passing through agricultural farmland, off the beaten track, and up an unadopted road, we come to the property we're here to see.
Here we go. It's a very, very pretty 19th century cottage. What do you think?
Yeah, I love it. It's really pretty.
The fact that it's detached, is that a positive?
That's a positive, definitely. I'm more than happy so far.
Why don't we go and take a look inside the house? Because I think we're off to a really good start with this one.
Originally starting life as two separate cottages in the early 1800s, but later knocked into one, this pretty property is nestled on the hillside, looking out over uninterrupted views. Surrounded by a generous garden with steps that take us down to the patio and front porch.
So we come straight into the kitchen. And what I really love about this house is that it's so snug and so cosy, with lots of character. You've got a friend there in the corner. I know you and your animal.
Is he staying?
Sadly, he's not.
I like the units. Yeah. I would like it. What do you think, Mirella?
You're quiet.
No, I mean, it's a nice little kitchen.
It's got everything. It feels nice. So I'm quite happy with it, actually.
It's cosy, isn't it?
Well, let's go off and explore the rest of the downstairs.
A long, wide property, this home is just one room deep. And on the ground floor, the kitchen leads to two reception rooms. Right next door to the kitchen is the first of these, currently used as a cosy snug with a stove. Then neighbouring this is the main living room, which has a big feature fireplace.
Wow. Oh, Mirella, look at that.
What a lovely fireplace.
A bread oven.
Yeah.
It's welcoming.
That is beautiful.
It is, isn't it? And it's cosy as well.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see myself here.
The fact that Julie is picturing herself here is a really encouraging sign. Upstairs, there are three equally charming bedrooms and the family bathroom. One of the bedrooms is a good-sized double, another is slightly smaller with bunk beds. And finally, the one where Julie might sleep.
So this is the master bedroom. It's nice and bright in there.
Yeah.
What do you think?
First impressions, yeah, good. I like it. I do like the footed wardrobes. I can see I could maybe change a few things in here, reveal the floor again. Yeah, I think make my mark on this as well.
That is a really nice size room.
Now, one thing that I've realised about you is that as much as the house has to be great, it's the outside that matters just as much. So let's not keep you in suspense any longer. Let's go and explore outside.
Back through the house and outside, steps lead up to an extensive garden and the first of a number of lawn terraces.
As you can see, it's long and it's narrow, but it is actually quite a good size. OK, so you've got the area down at the bottom that you could easily keep chickens in, and then you've got the stepped areas here with some amazing views from the area up at the top where there's a really pretty garden swing.
It is long and thin. I'm not sure whether it's big enough.
Now, I'm not going to be able to spring a surprise on you like I was yesterday. However, the farmer who lives just down the lane manages and farms all the land around here, and there could be a conversation to be had with him about potentially leasing some land.
I've always felt that as long as there was that possibility, I wouldn't rule it out, definitely.
There may not be acres, but I'm glad Julie is keeping an open mind regarding the potential here. And up a few more small steps is a vantage point that might persuade her further.
Mm. The climb's worth it, isn't it? Mm. It's really pretty.
That's beautiful. That's idyllic countryside, isn't it? It's just, yeah.
It is lovely.
So, what do you think this one is on the market for?
I think, although it hasn't got the land, I think because of the location, I think I'm going to be optimistic and say 360.
John would have said that as well.
OK. Well, you can both...
You can say that.
Yeah, I think around that price. I think she's right.
I'm sorry to say that you are both wrong, unfortunately. It's actually on the market for less than that. And it's on for £315,000.
That's quite a drop, isn't it, to what we thought?
Wow. Wow, now that puts...
things into perspective, doesn't it?
Different, yeah. Wow, that's amazing.
£315,000.
Well, yeah, that is such good news. That gives me a nice little bit of money to do what I really want to do.
Lot to see, lot to think about at this point now. Mm. Why don't you wander back inside, start thinking about where you could put your own stamp on it?
I was amazed with the price. That was such good news to the ear. It's really thrown the cat amongst the pigeons. I really like it. After yesterday, I didn't think that anything would beat that, but I can see such a lot of potential here. Lots of different things that I could do.
How about if we could maybe knock through here to open up this space into a kitchen diner?
I think Julie has got more potential of making it her own here. It's a little bit remote, and that's what she likes, so I think, ideally, this could be the place for her.
I'm just admiring this beautiful courtyard garden. It's, there's so much going on with this house.
There's so much you could do with it, yeah.
Mm. How are you feeling?
A bit overwhelmed again.
Okay. And guess what? We've got the mystery house to see next.
Come on.
Just 50 years ago, the county of Devon had one of the highest concentrations of traditional orchards in the country, and the area was once known as the cider capital of England. But now that a significant proportion of our apples are imported or commercially farmed, many heritage varieties are under threat, along with the wildlife which depends on these orchard ecosystems. So to find out about the importance of preserving our traditional orchards, I've come to meet Ed Nicholson, head ranger at the Killerton Estate near Broadclist, where the apple harvest is in full swing.
Ed, just walking through here on this beautiful sunny day surrounded by apple trees, you will be forgiven for thinking that small orchards like this are alive and well and thriving here in Devon, but sadly that's not the case, is it?
No, not really. Across the region, we've lost about 90% of the orchards here in the southwest.
I mean, how is that happening? Because obviously the demand for apples is still there. People want to eat them, they want to drink apple juice, they want to drink cider.
They do. The demand's higher than ever, really. To harvest apples from these sorts of trees basically is very labour-intensive.
So what we're doing, we're just sticking to a few mainstream varieties that are easier, less complex to grow, and all these traditional trees are just disappearing.
To a greater or lesser degree, yeah.
So why is it important, Ed, that orchards like this, these smaller orchards, thrive?
These are a really, really special habitat. I mean, so you just feel it on a day like this. It's a magical place to be. So calm, so peaceful, and yet they're just so ripe for wildlife. Basically, we use 100% of the fruit that's in these orchards. Only 50% of it goes for humans. 50% of it we leave behind for the overwintering birds, the insects, and all of the cycles that go on with that. These particular trees, they're very old. They're quite gnarly, and basically they've got a lot of lichen in there. They've got a lot of interest from the mosses on there, and they're just a great habitat.
How do we ensure then that things don't get worse and that small orchards like this are there for future generations to enjoy?
Go and taste and experience your local varieties. And then if you've got a bit of ground, they do say five trees makes an orchard. So, you know, get five trees, plant your own traditional orchard.
Well, I've got one. I'm on the way.
There are over 6,000 different apple varieties in Britain, and the estate here is home to around 100 of them, with at least 70 in this orchard alone. 12 tonnes of the fruit are used to make cider for the estate, mostly collected by community groups and volunteers. And I'm told that it's only after I've joined the harvest with Ed and Molly that I'm allowed to taste some.
You have one of those.
Thank
I'll have
you.
One of these. By the time we fill these up, we should have enough.
OK. Molly's pinched an apple.
I was going to say, she helps to pick them up already. So basically, we want everything that's nice and firm, that's reasonable to eat.
OK.
We don't want anything that's mouldy.
Unlike eating apples, cider apples are picked from the ground. For it's at the point that they're ready to drop that they have the highest sugars and starches needed to make sweet cider.
I guess if most of us were asked to name a few varieties of apple, we could probably come up with four or five. You've got an awful lot more than that growing here, haven't you?
There are, yeah, and each area would have its own, and they'd often be named after where they were born. So basically, two varieties that came from the estate here, Killerton Sweet, Killerton Sharp.
So what's the ratio then? Is that going to get me a decent amount of cider?
Almost a pint.
That's OK, that'll do.
That'll do for a
start. I don't need more than a pint.
I add my somewhat slim pickings to the apples collected earlier.
How many's in the bag?
Probably about 300 kilos in there.
That's a hefty weight of apples to shift, so Ed fires up the tractor. And I help him fix the bag in place before we transport the fruit down to the estate's 200-year-old cider press.
Oh, my goodness me. That is a press, isn't it? Wow.
Yeah, quite a beast, isn't it? But yeah, this is our press. This is where we turn all the apples into the juice, which we then ferment into the cider.
Now, I'm guessing it's not going to do that on its own.
It's not. And as ever, we rely heavily on our volunteers. So, are you ready, guys?
No pesticides or chemicals are used, just pure unadulterated fruit and a whole lot of elbow grease. The juice is fermented for about 6 months before the cider is ready, but my mouth is watering now, so I'm going to sample some of the raw juice direct from the press.
That's delicious. It's so sweet and zingy and fresh tasting. I've never tasted apple juice as good as that before.
Oh, this is very raw apple juice.
Cheers.
The 50 acres of orchards on this estate may now be a drop in the ocean compared to the numbers that once existed in Devon, but it's encouraging to witness and taste how every drop of the produce grown here is supporting the local wildlife and fruit-growing heritage that was once so prevalent across the county's fertile landscape. For our mystery house, we're making our way to the village of Bratton Fleming. A large village close to both the coast and the countryside, Bratton Fleming is set on a hillside, right on the fringes of the Exmoor National Park, so plenty of walking opportunities on the doorstep. Residents are served by a church dating back to the mid-19th century, a village shop and pub, so there are lots of ways to get to know the local community. Since Julie will be moving out to Devon on her own, it's this potential social connection that's prompted our choice for the mystery property. It lies right on the main street, smack bang in the centre of the village.
So, the mystery house is right here in front of us. So it's an old schoolhouse.
It's a chapel.
Yeah, it was attached to the chapel, which is a separate building on the right. The schoolhouse on the left dates back earlier to 1881. What do you think?
It's different.
Different in a good way, different in a bad way.
No, it looks very attractive, actually. Yeah, well, what do you think, Mel?
I think it looks lovely.
I think you're going to be in for a pleasant surprise when we open the door.
Really?
Come on.
Yeah.
Despite being in the heart of the village, they both seem impressed by the outside of our mystery house. Converted in 2007, the interior is a prime example of historic character and contemporary design combined, Renovated to a high standard, it also features a unique inverted layout.
It's an upside-down house.
Oh, is it?
Which means the main living space is upstairs, so shall we head straight up?
Yeah.
The main living area may be upstairs, but the majority of the accommodation lies on the ground floor and includes 4 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms and a kitchen diner. But to really set the scene of what this unique property has on show, we're starting up at the top.
So up here is the main living area. They took full advantage of the space. It's so bright, light, airy, vaulted ceilings, original beams.
It is a wow.
It's definitely a wow.
I love it.
The windows are lovely.
It's amazing.
Gorgeous, isn't it?
I mean, it is beautiful. Mm.
The mystery house has clearly thrown Julie a curveball. The 4 bedrooms downstairs lead off a central hallway, 3 of which are light and bright and vary in size. There's also a modern tile bathroom. And down a small step, we come to the master bedroom.
It's ensuite bathroom, just attached there, and the nice high ceiling, it gives it that really bright, airy feeling in here.
Certainly bright.
It's a lovely size room, isn't it?
Could you imagine yourself in here, Julie?
I could imagine sleeping here.
But not living?
No, maybe not.
What is it about it that's not appealing to you?
It's not cosy. I like the cosy feeling. It is very white, and that can be a bit cold, I think. No, it's not to my taste.
The stark, clean lines may not be suited to Julie, but I've a sneaky suspicion that Morella might be sold. Back up the step and right at the end of the corridor, we come to the final room on our tour.
The second wow factor part of this house, I think, is here, the kitchen dining space with its vaulted ceiling.
Yeah.
And more beams.
Hey!
That is a wow.
Oh, this is nice, isn't it?
It's been nicely done.
It has.
Very well done.
Because obviously very contemporary, but I think they've managed to get that blend of the old features.
It's lovely.
It is lovely.
Yeah. I can't deny it's lovely.
So what do you think as mystery houses go, Julie?
It's pretty much on the spot, I think, as a mystery house.
I mean, it's such a beautiful finish. It's got this contemporary feel, which I know isn't your cup of tea necessarily, but I do think it's combined with the original features really beautifully.
It's very well done.
There's still more to see, so let's head outside and let's see if the garden can sway you more in the direction of this house.
OK.
Well, one half of the pair is impressed, but sadly not the one who's actually buying. Stepping out into the sunshine, the rather compact back garden is the last place to see.
Ta-da! Here it is. That's the other mystery. You could definitely keep a chicken or two in here.
Yeah.
You could. Mirella, I can just tell from your face that this house really appeals to you. It might not be for
Julie's
Julie.
Taste, but No, I think it's lovely. You can sit outside and have a coffee, a little barbie. It's a small garden, but it's really pleasant, isn't it?
OK, I'm going to put you on the spot. Your budget is £350,000, going up to £375,000 if you needed to. What do you think this one is on the market for?
You go first.
£360,000.
Julie?
I'm going to go £340,000.
OK, you're both wrong, I'm afraid. But, Julie, you're most wrong out of the two of you. It's actually on the market for £375,000, so not too far off, Morella. Uh-huh. And it's a beautifully finished house in a fantastic location. Mm. So... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's. I won't deny it's a lovely, lovely house.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I think for Morella's sake, you just have to go back inside and have another look around and just take your time.
Look in the kitchen.
At £375,000, the Mystery House is an incredible contemporary conversion of an original Victorian schoolhouse. Featuring a topsy-turvy layout, it has 4 bedrooms, a spacious living room, as well as a large kitchen diner. And the property lies right in the middle of a desirable village.
As a mystery house, it lived up to its name. Certainly gave me a surprise.
conversion from an old school is just amazing. The design is incredible, especially upstairs. The windows, all the features, it is stunning.
I love this house. It's gorgeous. This isn't the type of house that Julie would live in. It's too modern for her. It's not warm enough, as in it's too white. But I love it. I think it's gorgeous.
Well, that's all the houses seen. So I guess it's time for you two to have a chat, and for you in particular, Julie, to do some thinking.
Yeah.
Well, it's been a lovely few days, and it's fantastic that a couple of properties seem to have really struck a chord with Julie. I can't wait to hear what she's going to do next. Hello.
Hi.
Well, end of the search here in Devon. I think that two houses seem to really stand out for you, but I've got no idea where your thoughts lie at this moment in time, so come and put me out of my misery.
I'm not really sure where my thoughts lie. The house with the land is a definite. I fell in love with that. It was wonderful. And then this morning, I was sent into confusion with the cottage. Yeah. That was lovely as well. And I'm really torn between the two at the moment. I've really got to, I think, go back and see them and weigh up the pros and cons for both of them.
Well, that's a great, fantastic, promising start. So just talk me through what the pros and cons are on the two of them for you.
The house with the land. The land is a huge, huge bonus. And the kitchen there was particularly lovely. The boot room for the dogs, that was great. I guess the main con there was the price. The cottage today hasn't got the land. However, hopefully I'll be able to get in touch with the farmer to see whether there's some way I can rent some land from him. The actual cottage I thought was lovely. It had a lot of potential. A few things needed doing, but as it's quite below budget, that gave me the funds to be able to make those changes, yeah.
So where do you go from here?
Tomorrow, we're going to go back and have a look at both with the surrounding areas and hopefully come to a decision as to which I'd like to pursue.
That is a brilliantly positive, you know, position to be in at the end of this search. It's absolutely fantastic to have not one, but two potentials. It's been wonderful being part of your search here. And I just really hope that when you go back and you explore more, one of them stands out for you and becomes your home here in Devon.
So do I. I'm so grateful. Thank you very much for all your help. It's been wonderful.
It's the end of our search here in Devon, and it's wonderful that Julie has found not just one, but two properties that she can imagine living in. We really hope that one of them will become her new home here in Devon and wish her lots of luck with her move to this beautiful county. Join me next time on Escape to the Country. If you would like to escape to the country in England, Scotland, Wales or Northern Ireland and need our help, please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.